the Football Hall of Fame. What a place. Now, what a place and what a group of people. Your executives could not have been nicer. They are tremendous people. And they were rough people. I'll tell you what, I wouldn't want to play around with any of them. Those are football players, a little bit retired, but that's okay. But I just want to tell you, that is some incredible museum. So thank you. So Ohio is a very, very special place to me. You know, I worked here for a pretty long period of time during summers in Cincinnati, good old Cincinnati. And I loved it, and I loved the people of Ohio. And we just got some good news because we just had some polls come out. So this morning, CNN came out, or Bloomberg came out, and we were 48 to 43. And then we just got one a little while ago, and that was a big one, and that was 48 to 43, so these polls are seeming to be pretty close. We have one that just came out in Florida, a big one, CNN, I believe it was CNN, and that one is up 3 in Florida. We're up sort of like... This is a movement. States are in play that no Republican has ever come close to winning. States are in play that the Republicans fly over those states. Me, we're going to land there. We're going to do a little fun. But we have a lot of states in play that are not usually in play. In fact, for many, many decades in some cases, just not in play for Republicans, and they're really in play for us. I think we are going to have an unbelievable November 8th. Gotta get out of here. So the people of the United States are truly, and you can see that by looking at this incredible crowd, ready for change. They're ready to discard a failed political establishment that disdains, disrespects, and looks down on hard-working, great people. This election is about a choice between the control of an arrogant ruling class in Washington, D.C. versus the hopes and dreams of everyday citizens. For years, our leaders have looked out only for themselves. There is no greater example of this in our country than Flint, Michigan, and what's happened. The city of Flint was once known as Buick City. More than 80,000 workers were employed by GM in 1970, not so long ago. Today, it's less than 8,000, and they're disappearing fast. And now, today, and I've been talking about it. Today, it was just announced, he's right, Ford. It's moving all of its small vehicle production to Mexico. I've been talking about it. I've been talking about this, folks, for 5 years, long before I said, let's run for president. Something I didn't particularly want to do, but we're doing a good job. You agree? We're doing it. A good job. I'm the messenger. The message is a good message, though. It's a message of competence. It's a message of jobs, jobs, jobs. It's a message of fixing our military, which is so depleted. The greatest people. It's a message of taking care of our great vets. They're treated worse than illegal immigrants, believe me, in many cases. It's a message of saving our Second Amendment, which is totally under siege. it's a message of Supreme Court justices. Remember that. 40% of Flint's residents are living in absolute total poverty. Violent crime is among the nation's highest. Today, I went to Flint to address the water crisis. The water crisis in Flint demonstrates failure at every single level of government, gross incompetence. Can you imagine? To save a couple of bucks, they spend hundreds of millions of dollars and they start taking water from a dirty area. From water that's so disgusting. It's tragic and it's heartbreaking and it should never happen in the United States of America. A thing like that should never happen. This is the catastrophe that does happen when we build up other countries instead of our own. We take care of everybody else. It's America first now, folks. America first. As I was in Flint and met some incredible people, people that have really suffered, people that can't wash their dishes, their hands were all blistered and terrible. And I just thought, thank you. Whoever that guy is, he's amazing. Whoever that is, I like that man. It used to be, think of this, is this true? It used to be cars were made in Flint and you couldn't drink the water in Mexico. Now, the cars are made in Mexico, and you can't drink the water in Flint. I hate to say that, but it's true, it's true, it's true. I mean, I can say it to you folks, so, and I've said this before. I have a friend who builds the biggest plants in the world. That's what he builds. If you said build an apartment, he wouldn't know where to begin. He builds plants, massive plants for automobiles, for computers. He's the biggest. And I said to him, so how are we doing? He said, unbelievable, Donald. Business is fantastic. I said, great, great. Where, really? Tell me where. Oh, Mexico. I said, what about our country? Not so much. He said, we are building the most incredible plants in Mexico. It's the eighth wonder of the world. NAFTA has killed us. Our stupid politicians have killed us. And we're going to turn it around. We're going to bring our jobs back. And we're going to start protecting our people. Driving through the city, you see the shuttered homes and businesses. The dilapidated infrastructure, like you don't see anywhere. You don't see this in third world countries. This is the United States. You don't see it in third world countries. And by the way, I watched Obama yesterday. In. I just wonder. But this is what our politicians have done to Flint, and this is what our politicians have done to America. But nowhere has the pain been worse than our inner cities. Democratic politicians have run our inner cities for 50, 60, 70, even in some cases 100 years straight without interruption. Their policies have produced massive poverty, joblessness, and failing schools. They've trapped Americans in suffering for years, and I'm running to offer a much better future, not only to the inner cities, but to America. Lower crime, better schools, more jobs, safety, security, opportunity. Now, I understand there are going to be some people in these communities who aren't planning on voting for me, and that's okay. I will campaign hard for their votes anyway. We can't stay the course. We have to do it properly. We can't keep doing it the way it's being done right now by our politicians. They're selling our nation down the tube. In the inner cities, keep voting, or we will build a wall. Don't worry about it. We will build a wall. We will build a wall, and we'll stop those drugs from pouring in. We will build a wall, and who is going to pay for the wall? More fun and more safe than a Trump rally. If you keep voting for the same people, you'll keep getting the same rotten results. I'm willing to campaign anywhere. I'm willing to go anywhere, visit anywhere. Even if some voters openly oppose me in the community, I think that's fine. That's their prerogative. I will listen, and I will represent them if and when we win. They will be properly represented. Hillary Clinton.
Because that's where her donors and special interests want. I'm not
be President of the United States. And so many other places, including even Canton. And I love this. And I'll be back. I'll be back. If we don't break free from our partisan boxes, and that's exactly what they are, then nothing will ever change. It's time to vote for America and America first. We have to do it. Will cost $400 billion. Think of it. That's enough money to rebuild the entire water infrastructure of the United States. President Obama just announced a 30% increase to refugee admissions coming into this country. This was hard to watch this morning. I saw it this morning. I said, I have to mention it. Bringing the total to 110,000 refugees in just a single year. And we have no idea where they come from, folks. This could be the great Trojan horse. And I don't want to be known in 200 years for having created the Trojan horse with a different name. We don't know where these people come from. We don't know if they have love or hate in their heart. And there's no way to tell. We'll build safe zones. We'll build safe zones. We owe, as you know, $20 trillion, double the debt during the Obama years, double the, did you see this? Double, more than double by the time he gets out. $20 trillion. We will have the Gulf states pay for it. We will lead it, but they will pay for it. And we'll build safe zones, but we can't let these people come into our country. We have enough problems. And I have to tell you, Hillary Clinton wants a 550% increase over and above what President Obama has been bringing in. He's been bringing in thousands, and she wants to increase it by 550%. What is going on? What's going on? Instead of providing free health care and jobs to millions of refugees, we need to rebuild our inner cities and take care of our struggling Americans, and we have plenty of them, believe me. Our support comes from every single part of America and every walk of life. You are the cops and the soldiers, the mechanics and the accountants, young and old, black, white, Latino. You are moms and dads, children, grandparents. You're from cities small and large and in between. But above everything else, you are Americans, and we have to straighten out our country. Hillary Clinton's attacks on you display the same sense of arrogance and entitlement that led her to violate federal law as Secretary of State, hide and delete her emails, destroy her iPhones with a hammer, put classified information into the reach of our enemies, lie to Congress, and sell government favors and access through the Clinton Foundation. Now, the same people who destroyed the emails are pleading the Fifth Amendment in front of Congress. You saw that today, yesterday. Fifth Amendment. There is no greater threat to democracy than public official puts their office up for sale. Look at what she did with Russian uranium. You know what uranium is used for? Or with UBS Bank, or with the contracts in Haiti. Hillary Clinton's record as Secretary of State is one of historic failure. Everything went wrong. Just look at what she did to the Middle East, in Iraq, in Syria, in Libya. Not to mention her failures in Russia, China, and North Korea. Look at what's happened. One failure after another, all while raising millions and millions and millions of dollars from her friends on Wall Street, many of whom I know. Many of whom I know. The policies of Hillary Clinton have produced only destruction overseas and poverty at home. That's what's happened. One in five American households do not have a single member in the labor force. Another 14 million people left the labor force entirely since 2009. And the national debt has doubled over the last 7.5 years. And remember this, it's not only doubled, but our country's a mess. Because we haven't done anything with it except waste it. Our roads are bad. Everything's bad. We're in such bad shape. It's one thing it doubles, but everything's tippy-top. Everything's a mess. And we have $20 trillion in debt. I'm running to reverse these policies and to create a future of prosperity for all Americans. My economic agenda can be summed up in three words. Jobs, jobs, jobs. And that begins with a new America First trade policy. These deals we make, folks, it's almost like we want to take it away from our country and let other countries make fortunes. And you know what? All they do is laugh at us, disrespect us. Look at that horrible deal we made with Iran, where they're now threatening to shoot down our planes. They have their little boats circling our beautiful big destroyers. And our great men are sitting there watching, saying, oh, would I like to give it to them. I know those captains and I know those people in those boats, and boy, would they like to give it to them. You know, it's amazing. We made this horrible, horrible deal. And instead of being thankful, we gave them $150 billion. Gave back all that money. And then, how about this? How about this? $1.7 billion in cash. In cash. Remember we thought it was 400? We thought it was 400 million. And we were wrong, it was 1.7 billion. Whoever saw 1.7, that'd be like to the ceiling and back a few times. I'll tell you what, who is doing this? Who's doing this? Correct. Hillary Clinton's bad judgment, and she suffers from terribly bad judgment. And the first one to bring that to our attention was Bernie Sanders, who is not a happy camper right now. Because they have totally disrespected Bernie Sanders. I mean, he almost beat her. He had to fight a rigged system. He had to fight superdelegates. And Bernie Sanders and I are very similar in one thing, trade. Trade. Other than I will make great trade deals, he just wants to end the bad ones, and who knows what's going to happen. But he knew that we were being ripped off on trade. But he's been totally disrespected by Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton's bad judgment was seen in her support of Bill Clinton's NAFTA, worst deal ever made in the history of our country, for economics, economic development. You know, if you look at trade deals, not just in the United States, NAFTA was the worst deal ever made in the history of the world. It was a one-way highway out of the United States with everybody. You know, people are making less real wages today than they made 18 years ago. They're older, they're working harder, And in some cases, now they have two jobs. It's supposed to be the other way around. You're not supposed to be working as hard, and you're supposed to be doing better. Now, I have to tell you, me, I'm working harder also, so I don't feel sorry for anyone.
You think this is easy? You think this is so easy? In this beautiful room that's 122 degrees? It is hot, and it's always hot when I perform because the crowds are so big. These rooms were not designed for this kind of a crowd.
That does any business outside of its borders. Ohio has lost 1 in 3 manufacturing jobs since NAFTA and 1 in 4 since China entered through the Clintons, the World Trade Organization. Our trade deficit in goods with the world, who are these people that make these deals? Our trade deficit is almost $800 billion a year. Think of this. Who makes these deals? Who makes these deals? Believe me, I will renegotiate. You see, I already started that process. 2 weeks ago, I met with the president of Mexico. You all saw, right? And he's a very nice guy. And I know that he will be thrilled when I tell him, we're building a wall and you're paying for it. And I will bring back vehicle production to the United States of America. That includes Ohio, and it includes Michigan, and it includes all of the states that are being ripped off. Mexico is becoming the car capital of the world. We got to bring back our jobs first. We have to bring them back. And folks, just so I can explain, because for years I've been watching, 10 years I've been watching our jobs disappear, longer than that. They go, we do nothing about it. There are going to be consequences when a company leaves, goes to Mexico or some other place, thinks they're going to build cars or air conditioners like Carrier or something, make them, sell them back into our community through our very powerful and strong border, which will be very powerful, very strong, and think that they're going to do that without repercussion. Not going to happen, folks. Not going to happen. When I, and I want to do it myself so badly, but I'm not supposed to be doing this as president, you understand. I'm supposed to be sitting back, but I just love doing it. It's so easy. It's so easy, it's like 4 or 5 minutes of calls. You call the head of, let's not use a name. Ford, okay. And you say, listen, got a problem. You're closing up all small cars. That's a big deal, right? Small cars, that's a big deal. And you're moving them all to Mexico. But here's the story, folks. If you're gonna build your new factory, maybe done by my friend, his plant, if you're gonna build that new factory, and if you think you're going to make cars and you're gonna sell them tax-free, you're gonna sell them right through our border like we're stupid people, not gonna happen that way. We're gonna charge you. We're going to charge you a 35% tax on every car that's made outside of the United States. And you know what? It's not too late. today is they think that I'm going to win and they want to beat the deadline. But let me tell you, there is no deadline. We can do it anyway. But if you think that you're going to do that, not going to happen. Now, let me tell you what will happen. 97.2%, they won't move. They'll say, this guy's tough, we're not going to move. Now, they may move, frankly, from Ohio or from Michigan to another state. That's okay. Do we agree? You know, they got to fight. I mean, I can only do so much for you, Ohio and Michigan. Okay? But most likely, they're going to say,